أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الخلق وأعز المرسلين، أبي القاسم محمد بن عبد الله. وعلى آل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين وصحبه الأخيار المنتشبين، وعلى جميع الأنبياء والمرسلين من يوم آدم إلى قيام يوم الدين. In the name of Allah, the most beneficent and the most merciful. To wrap up last night's subject and at the same time make it kind of emphasis on it, when we spoke about كَلَّا بَلْ تُحِبُّونَ الْعَاجِلَةِ وَتَذَرُونَ الْآخِرَةِ, meaning that people prefer this world and neglect the world thereafter. And death is irreversible. Once we pass the threshold between this material life, life of the material, and the life thereafter, we cannot step back. The only thing that we will have is whatever we have saved of good deeds in this present life, because this life is the path to there. We save, because it's a journey. We're heading on a journey, and now we save for it. And like we said, there are multiple forms of charity that we can do. Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, says that smiling upon your human brother and sister is charity. Shaking your hand after this measure is charity. Continuous charity, on the other hand, streaming charity, is this charity that survives after your death, such as spreading education, planting a tree, supporting a mosque such as this mosque, and you'd be surprised, even heat bill to heat such a huge place is extremely expensive. You'd be shocked. All of that is sort of streaming charity or continuous charity that survives after your death and keeps adding up over and over and over and over until, you know, God knows, judgment day. So, since death is irreversible, we must always save for the life thereafter. And I will wrap up the subject with this point and move on to the next because we're tight with time. So, and also before we begin with the subject, since it's Ali al-Akbar's night, it may be noteworthy to mention that Ali al-Akbar, peace be upon him, he looked like Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. And Imam Hussein, peace be upon him, every time he wanted to see or remember Rasulullah, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, he used to look at the face of Ali al-Akbar, his son. And these people used to suffer. Some people say, oh, these people are imams and sons of imams. Oh no, they suffer. Ali al-Akbar, peace be upon him, came to his dad to Imam Hussein, peace be upon him, and told him, oh father, I'm so thirsty. Al-Imam Hussein, peace be upon him, told him, go fight, and then Prophet Muhammad, your grandfather, will make you drink from a cup where you will never feel thirst again. And imagine these people who killed a person who looked like their prophet, Shabah al-Rasul. So we see that these people in Ashura sacrificed not only fatigue, and, you know, they put their efforts and they sacrificed, you know, Imam Hussein, peace be upon him, sacrificed his son, his sons, his nephews, his nieces, and he was a human being. The fact that he cries tells you that Imam Hussein, peace be upon him, is a human being who suffers. Only he understands better because he knows that this life is a path. And now people tell us, why do you commemorate Ashura? And we decided that Ashura, as Imam Hussein, peace be upon him, did. He forgave, and he was so generous that he gave water to his enemies, to Al-Hur, Jaysh Al-Hur, on the way when they felt so thirsty. And Imam Hussein had water. He told his companions, give them water to drink. We learned from Ashura love. We learned that Imam Hussein used to stand just to save these people from hellfire and tell them and remind them of what's awaiting them if they kill him. We learned to reject humiliation, to live in honor, to always say no to tyrants that Imam Hussein, peace be upon him, said that Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, says that if any of you sees a tyrant jeweler who legalizes what Allah has forbidden, forbids what Allah has legalized, violates the Prophet's traditions and his households, and oppresses the worshippers and does not oppose him in deeds or words, Allah will judge his servant in the same manner as he treats the tyrant on Judgment Day. We learned from Ashura how to speak, because Sayyidah Zainab, peace be upon her, is the first female reporter in the history of mankind. How she was brave, she did not feel weak, she did not, yes, she suffered. Of course she suffered, but yet she was brave enough to always speak to people, inform them of the truth and explain it to them. She was brave enough to speak facing Yazid and tell him that فَاسْعَى سَعْيَكْ وَنَاصِبْ جُهْدَكْ. Put your effort, plot your plots. فَوَاللَّهْ لَا تَبْقُوا وَزِقْوَدَا. You will not erase our remembrance, you will not wipe out our spirit, because your days are numbered and your troops are, you know, will vanish. So when we commemorate Ashura, this is a school. We learn all of these things every single year. And you'd be surprised how much the world fears this. The world fears Ashura. You see them shutting down TV stations on a daily basis. It's because they fear the word, especially Ashura. Some countries ban such commemorations. It's because they know this is a school. Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, says, one knowledgeable servant or worshipper is more difficult on the devil than 1,000 ignorant worshippers. Is this hadith for just Ahlul Dhikr? Is this only for the scholars? No, it's for us. He didn't say this is only for scholars. He clearly, explicitly said, one knowledgeable worshipper is more difficult on the devil than 1,000 ignorant worshippers. Al-Quran, Al-Kareem, begun with the word recite. Recite in the name of your Allah or your Lord who created. Al-Quran in itself means recite. Every single word in the Quran emphasizes knowledge and education. It does not emphasize knowledge. It emphasizes comprehensive knowledge. And there's a huge difference. We can read Quran all we want. If we cannot understand what we are reading, I mean, of course, we're gaining rewards because it washes our hearts from rust and stuff. But how much are we gaining? The good is he who can comprehend the Holy Quran, even if it were a few verses. Interestingly, the Holy Quran in Surah Al-Jum'ah, because today is Friday Eve, refers to people who do not comprehend what they read as كَمَثَلِ الْحِمَارِ يَحْمِلُ أَسْفَارًا. Like a donkey carrying a lot of books. Can a donkey carrying a lot of books understand what these books or what the content of these books mean? No. Is this how we want to be? Of course not. And that's why we always commemorate Ashura, we need to learn. And that's why Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, always emphasized education. If we read Surah Al-Rum, and almost much of it, it says, وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ أَنْحَفْ of his signs is that he created, and then goes on to say, and that are signs for people who reflect, and that are signs for people who can think, and that are signs, it goes on and on. And Surah Al-Ghashiyah, it says, أَفَلَا
يَنْظُرُونَ. Oh, they look!
Don't they look how camels were created? It goes on and on and on. Every single scripture in the Holy Quran emphasizes education. In the name of Allah, the most compassionate and the most merciful. تبارك الذي جعل في السماء بروجا وجعل فيها سراجا وقمرا منيرا. Blessings be to He, to Allah, who created in the skies or in the heavens planets and stars and put in it siraj. I looked at translations of this or explanations. There's nothing that's close to accurate. Some called it sun, but siraj is more than a sun. Others refer to it as lantern. It's both. وَقَمَرًا مُنِيرًا, and a luminous moon. So Al-Quran, 1400 years ago is trying to tell us that the sun is the source of light and the moon is just luminous or shining in glory, according to some other explanations. Every single word in the Holy Quran emphasizes this, and we will go over more verses by and by, because this is tomorrow's subject as well, God willing. It reminds me of multiple stories. You know, like Al-Shaykh Al-Ha'i last night said to our Sunni brothers to read their books. Because I have a personal friend who lives in Syria who was a Sunni. And when he actually discovered that one of his best friends was Shia, he decided to convert him. So he started reading. And guess what? He converted himself to Shia. And that's one of many stories. This one is, he told me. I can tell you about personal stories that I have myself seen here. I once discussed this with a Christian. I always debate stuff with Christian people. And they were trying to convert me to Christianity. And I said, if you can tell me where Trinity exists in your Bible, maybe I will think about it. And this particular girl, I told her Trinity was established or formed in 320 by the Council of Nicaea. She didn't know it. She looked it up. She's like, he's right. She researched the Bible. He's right. She looked at me. Some months later, she emailed me. She said, I'm just letting you know that I have taken Shahada just today. She converted. From that we can see how important education is. How important, not education, comprehensive education. Comprehensive knowledge. I have once, well, multiple times, seen people who are misled. I remember this, I was at Western Michigan University back in summer 2004, and I met this girl, Egyptian convert from Islam to Christianity. And she was telling me that she was a Muslim and she used to pray 5 times a day. Obviously, we're talking about Egypt, but I told her, what do you know about Islam? That's the problem, my dear brothers and sisters. Most of us do not know Islam, even though she didn't know Islam. That's the problem. If you don't know Islam, Jehovah's Witnesses will come to you, and they, because they are trying to do this, they know about Islam more so than you do, and they will tell you, look, we are right, you are wrong. Remember the scriptures we discussed, in the name of Allah, the most compassionate and the most merciful. Fight in the way of Allah, those who fight you, and do not transgress. Allah does not like transgressors. And kill them wherever you find them. And expel them from wherever they have expelled you. So they take this second scripture, they cut it out, and they bring it to you and says, look, Islam is a religion of terrorism. See, that's your Quran says. Your Quran says that. If you do not know and cannot look this verse up and read it from verse Surah Al-Baqarah, Surah verse 190 to verse 194, yeah, you'll be deceived. You'll be like, oh wow, I agree, Islam is a religion. That is what they do. I can go on and on and on about such scriptures. People, I remember very recently, maybe 3 months ago, one person was telling me the Quran is full of discrepancies and conflictions. I said, how? He told me, look, it says over here, في يوم كان مقداره 50,000 سنة, in a day that was like equivalent to 50,000 years. And over here it says, يوم عند ربك كألف سنة مما تعدون. A day at your Lord's or at the afterlife is like 1,000 years of what you count. I looked at this person and said, I know where you have gotten it or brought this from because I know the sources. But I want to show it to you. And I showed him how it says. 50,000 years, we are referring to a specific day, a judgment day. That's this one day is special, referred to as 50, equivalent to 50,000 years. The others is Adam and Barzakh, or, you know, the afterlife and so and such. So, no, it's not a God. But if you don't understand that, you say, oh, wow. And you'd be surprised. Now you'd say, oh, no. Brother Muhammad is not giving us the full picture. And yes, I'm not giving you the full picture because we're tight with time. But we'll go on over some more tomorrow, inshallah. some more probably interesting stuff, God willing. The thing is, what we're trying to say here is that if you do not comprehend, and I don't say understand, huge difference. If you do not comprehend Islam, the spirit of Islam, there is nothing easier than misleading you. There is nothing easier than telling you, look, Islam commands you to kill, and they overlook Surah Al-Ma'idah, verse 532, when it says, whomever kills a life without a just cause is as if he killed all without a just cause, or corruption on earth is as if he killed all mankind. And whomever revives a life is as if he saved all mankind. Or whoever saves a life is as if he saved all mankind. Sorry, I'm speaking fast. So, I'm virtually out of time for the day. Tomorrow we will finish the subject, God willing, because I think this is the cornerstone of Islam. If we cannot understand Islam, there's no question about the fact that we will deviate. آخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين أستغفر الله لي ولكم اللهم كن لوليك الحجة ابن الحسن صلواتك السلام عليك يا سيدي ومولاي يا أبا عبد الله وعلى الأرواح التي حلت بفنائك عليكم مني سلام الله أبدا ما بقيت وبقي الليل والنهار ولا جعله الله آخر عهد مني لزيارتكم السلام على الحسين وعلى علي بن الحسين وعلى أولاد الحسين وعلى أصحاب الحسين ورحمة الله وبركاته لقضاء حوائج المؤمنين والمؤمنات وشفاء مرضاهم لا سيما الحاضرين والمؤسسين ومن أوصانا بالدعاء خاصة رحم الله من قرأ الفاتحة تسبقها الصلاة على محمد وآل محمد